names that are like so long that I tend not to use them because I'm a simple guy. And
Are the technical names based on, for instance, cauliflower, but it doesn't say cauliflower? If it's a microgreen, it has a different name for cauliflower?
No, for that category, cauliflower, broccoli, cabbage, watercress.
Okay, for the whole category. Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. So I just call it the cabbage family. And that for me, it tells me certain things. It tells me that the biggest micronutrients in that particular family. And it tells me broadly the taste, although it will vary slightly. But it gives me the consistency of the texture as well. So I sort of know something when I say cabbage family to myself. And but you don't have to worry about that. I mean, the second one, for example, the lettuce and our chicory, I call that the Aster family. Okay. And they are actually, they do all, the name is correct. It's not something I've pulled out of the air, but it's my side. Whereas this, the third one down, the dill, carrot, fennel, and celery, I call the carrot family. Okay. And that sort of focuses me on a lot of the things I've just mentioned. Garlic, onion, leek, you can call what you like. Alinium could be a good name. Then the second last one I call the green leafy family. Okay. And it really is. And they also have this particular, they've all got an amazing amount of nutrients, but each category, you know, it has at least one or two that are dominant compared to other categories. And then the gourd family, maybe in under, you know, melon and so on. But they are, you know, they're also, you know, these are not the only, these are the most popular ones. These are the ones that I recommend you look at and start with. And we will talk more about it, but you can have cereals such as rice as well, and oats and wheat, barley. They all can make microgreens, and you know, legumes like chickpeas. I do chickpeas actually. They go quickly and well and fast, so quickly, yeah. So beans also, beans get very tall and so on. So there are a lot of things that you can grow. And I'm going to, by the end of the class, I want you for yourself just to focus in on something that resonates with you. You know, I think that might be a good one to start for me, for whatever that reason happens.
Michael, can you buy a salad mix?
Can you buy a salad mix?
In other words, can you mix the beans up? And do they germinate at certain periods of time? Is that the whole thing? Is you want them to germinate at the same time? And if you had different seeds in there, they might germinate differently.
Oh, I see what you mean by mix. Sorry.
Yeah, that's why I'm just saying a salad mix of seeds.
You can. I took only a month ago, I took my cereal that I had bought from the organic shop, not for, you know, just of seeds, you know, like chai seeds and all this.
Yeah.
In a muesli, okay? And I just spread them out in one of my pots, and I put soil on them and I watered them, and they grew.
Okay, so there we go. So you've got a mix of beans.
Yeah, but you also, there are things you're going to need to watch out for, because every seed sprouts and grows at a different rate.
Yeah, that's why I said that would be the problem.
Yeah, and it can be, but it's not necessarily a problem, because you can harvest those that have grown and you can leave it in there waiting for the other ones to get to a point of harvest. So they might be a week apart from each other, but that's fine. You know, you're going to harvest them with a pair of scissors, and we'll talk about that when we
get... Okay, so you don't pull them out by the root.
Oh, no, you don't eat the root. Okay, let's talk about that now. You can see in the image here, you've got sprouts and you've got microgreens. Okay, we're looking at the difference between the two. Microgreens are grown in some sort of medium like soil. I grow in soil, but if you go and buy them online, you can get coconut like mats and things like that. all types of different things you can grow, and none of them are wrong. Okay, you can use all of them. Okay, I just have a preference, and I'll tell you later why. That's the one thing. And of course, sprouts are not grown in soil, as you know. I think we've all sprouted before in bottles, in water, and keeping them damp and aired and so on. Light is an issue with microgreens, all right? So I'm going to talk about that in a minute, because you can see the green and the green leaves, and you know that just the mere fact of looking at the green leaves is going to tell you something, okay? It's getting some extra nutrients over and above what the sprout has from the light, and even from a bit of sun that you might put into it, or a grow light that you might grow it under if you're growing down in the down below under the house or somewhere. Okay, so so light is an issue. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. Microgreens really need, once they have sprouted and they're up, then they need to be in good light. The brighter the light, the better, but not sunlight all day long. Although you use the same seeds for both sprouts and microgreens, you will find, if you do your research, that there are many more seeds as microgreens than sprouts, because you can't sprout all seeds and eat them, okay, for certain reasons. But we're not talking about sprouts now, okay? So, right. So why grow microgreens? Okay. The first one is you don't need a garden, Laura, to produce healthy mini vegetables. Okay, and that's what they are. You see, I'm emphasizing mini vegetables because what did you say when you, instead of the word microgreens, you said something in America that they could be, okay, I forget what one of you used a moment ago. But anyway.
Not seedlings, was it?
Seedlings. That's right. That's right. Okay. So, yeah. So anyway, thanks for that. And the other reason you're going to buy it is because when you reach my age, and you'll all reach my age one day, okay, and that is, you know, you need to be seriously looking at only eating organic, okay? And you will, if you have microgreens, you are growing them, and you are deciding what seeds you are going to plant and what medium they're going to grow in. And so, you know, you have 100% control. You know that they are then organic, and they're fresh when you need them. You don't have to pick on a certain day at an exact height. We'll come to that too. They are a superfood. Okay, that's my interpretation, because nobody can argue with me that because of all the nutrients in them, okay, they will build your immune system. Okay, and we'll talk a little bit more about that when we look at the nutrients. And so it's a practical method of ensuring availability of your vital nutrients. So they cover all the nutrients, even some of those rare ones, even some of those essential ones. Okay. You know, why haven't you already gone out and started microgreening? Okay. You know, you can stop the class and go and buy them quickly, you know, because of these reasons. Okay. And of course, they're very tasty. So, you know, your body needs a variety of nutrients. Your body stores certain nutrients. It doesn't store, you know, vitamin B's and C, but most of the others, it does. And so the health benefits are just amazing, okay? The microgreens have a high concentration of polyphenols. Okay? And if you go and ask your doctor, if you Google it, that'll like be the top of the list for, you know, anybody who thinks they know a little bit about nutrients. And polyphenols are just, it's a category. There are a lot of different polyphenols. But you know, it's a good place to start when you're thinking about your nutrients and why you are going here, because these little fellows are just loaded with phytonutrients, which falls under this category. And phytonutrients show to lower cholesterol and triglyceride symptoms for people who have rheumatic, arthritis, okay? Rheumatoid arthritis was the word I was looking for. And Alzheimer's disease, wow. And cancer, cardiovascular diseases, all the diabetes. The polyphenols and all the things that fall under the polyphenol. And you don't really need to know that. You just need to know that they do, okay? It helps your, if you want a strong immune system, you've got to make sure that your microbiome is healthy, okay? And that it's absorbed. You might be taking supplements, list of supplements. Do you know if they're actually working? Do you know if they've been absorbed? Okay, you don't know unless you have your urine tested, maybe. But really, with microgreens, the microgreen, whether you've got an unhealthy microbiome or a leaky gut, the microgreens are going to heal it regardless. Okay, so you know, you don't have to rush off to go and find out whether you are absorbing the nutrients, because with microgreens, it's got all the family of all the essentials in order to come together and heal your microbiome. It's just amazing. Improve your heart health. Unbelievable. And there's so much scientific evidence all over. You just got to go and Google it if you wanted that evidence, okay? And you know, heart disease is one of the, I think it's probably is the leading cause of death these days. I'm not talking about viruses and things, but you know, and then when all things are normal, isn't that going to be great one day?
We're gonna have a new normal.
Yes, you're right. But you know, we can also set our own parameters as well for our new normal, and I think that's really what I'm saying. And this is one of the things you can do, is grow microgreens. And
okay, now I have a question.
Yes.
What quantity of microgreens should one take every day? I mean, you're not making a salad of it, so you're sprinkling it on top of a salad, or are you blending it with?
It's a really an excellent question, Laura, because we are all unique individuals, and because we have a history of certain type of diet, maybe we've always been the green, maybe we've been a vegetarian or a vegan, and maybe we're not, we are actually a carnivore. And so that determines your microbiome that you have. So for different people, they would need to take different amounts. And the most important thing is regular eating of them. Okay, that's the most important. The quantity, you can never have too much. Let me put it to you, never have too much of microgreens. Okay. And too much will never make you sick, will never get your stomach moving or anything like that. Okay. So you decide for yourself. And you know, if you take a handful of microgreens in a day, and different varieties and something, it doesn't matter one variety or another, that's about what I would start with. And not necessarily increase, but a handful a day, you're getting what you should be getting. Okay. And so I hope that helps answer the question. Now, you know, the polyphenols also are antioxidants, okay, and have antioxidant properties, and you need those more so now at this age, because we are getting lots of these damaging free radicals running around our system, and can cause some major illnesses, and we need to be ensuring that our immune system can handle them. For immune system, need a good microbiome, and you need to be feeding the microbiome with something that has antioxidant properties, and that's microgreens across the board will have that. Okay. Now, the interesting thing with the nutrient content is that anything between 4 and 40 times the amount of nutrients in a microgreen compared to a fully grown plant. Okay. Now that's powerful. Okay. Why wait all the time and the effort for the plant to grow when you can get all the nutrients? Yes, you have vegetables in order to have something on your plate along with whatever your meal is. I go along with that. So you can still buy some organic vegetables just to put something on your plate if it's necessary. Okay. But they are the nutrients you will get from the microgreens, and you will not get them as anywhere near as much from a fully grown mature thing. You'd have to eat lots and lots of broccoli to get what a handful of broccoli or sprouts will give you. Okay. So,
if anyone's developed a microgreen diet, because you would not be consuming the amount of calories if you're just eating the microgreens.
Yeah, there is a lot on there about using microgreens and a microgreen diet and so on. I combined the two. My wife and I sort of have our normal meals and we add microgreens to those meals. That's it. Okay, so we haven't changed dramatically. And, I through my life, I've changed my diet dramatically. You know, I find the keto diet now is pleasant, and you just add some microgreens to the keto diet. And that's sort of a guideline for me. Certainly, I don't stick strictly to it.
You but take supplements along with this?
Yeah, I don't take supplements for the nutrients. I take supplements because historically, unknown to me, my kidney was eating the calcium out of my bones, and that made me, I couldn't walk, and incredible pain and stuff like that. And it also damaged the nerves. So I take a supplement that creates I've got it here, I'll show it to you. I can't actually see now because I can't see myself necessarily there, but I don't know if you can see that or not. But anyway.
Wait a minute. Do one more time, Michael.
Oh, all right. Okay.
I'm getting my pen.
Okay.
There you go. I can't, but we can't read it. What does it say?
Okay. It's a brand name, and then it's glucosamine and complex advanced. So it's called the sort of subheading is the comprehensive joint health support. Okay. Now,
interesting.
It's definitely working. I mean, you can ask my wife; she's behind me here somewhere. That if I stop taking this, that pain in the joints come back because they're in the process of healing now. And I don't know how long it's going to take, maybe 10 years to get back to what it was. I've only been taking this for 2 years, maybe. That's what I take that for. It's chemicals, and it works.
How did you find out about that? I have lupus, and when you talk about the joints, my cartilage actually explodes. And so that sounds very interesting to me.
Yeah, it would. You know, with lupus, yeah, your body's like eating itself. Okay.
Yeah.
And so the issue there is certainly. I've written. I never had lupus, but I refer to it in a lot of my articles on my website, and the nutrients that are needed. So if you go to my website, michaelplumstead.com, just my first name and surname.com. Okay. And rather than try and search through the stuff up, because I'm busy reorganizing my website into a different order, but the articles are all there, is just subscribe. Okay. I do a weekly newsletter about those nutrients that you with lupus would be needing. In other words, where do those nutrients come from? Okay, and the importance of certain aspects that are primary importance, okay, before you start with any other nutrients. Okay, you go there, but you can ask me questions from my website as well. Okay. Perfect. I don't want to waste other people's time.
No, it's good. Yep.
You're good. Okay. So let's start with any of these seeds. Okay. Now you can still start with anything that you want to start with for whatever reason. But if you just look at the pictures at a glance, okay. And you can see that they all got a different leaf, okay? As do the big plants of these same things. And now, all of these grow easily. Okay, other seeds there are some issues with sometimes, but anyway. Seeds want to grow, so it's really not difficult. You can choose what you like. But, take coriander, for example. It's a high source of fiber, but it's also got a lot of manganese, iron, magnesium as a part of the thing. And the leaves are rich in vitamin C and vitamin K. Okay. And you know what else? Protein. Okay.
Wow.
That's really, I find that very, very interesting. You know, it's got small amounts of other things.
Michael, can you shut everyone off because we're getting somebody's feedback?
Okay. Lester, please stop that feedback if you would. Okay. That's what Lester's here to do.
Okay. Oh, okay.
All right. Is that off now?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Lester. Okay. Yeah, so coriander, although it's, it's got that vitamin C and K in large quantities, it's got protein, it also has sort of much smaller stuff like calcium, okay, and phosphorus and potassium. But you see, for me to try and just stay on coriander for calcium after, 50 years of my kidneys eating the calcium out of my bone, I couldn't make it up. I would never be able to make it up through a diet. Okay. It's just it had gone too far. And you need the diet now to take care of now, not historical issues. And I guess with lupus, I guess you're probably born with it, were you? Or did you develop it? You don't know. Okay.
Yeah.
No, fair enough. Yeah. Okay. So, there's also in coriander something called luteolin, okay, which is a powerful flavonoid. And that's interesting because, as you probably know, that's part of the polyphenol family, okay. But if you've ever had to have chemo, okay, you take this will help you recover from chemo, okay.
Wow.
So
I am in recovery from breast cancer treatment, not chemo, but radiation. And they do have me on a heavy dose of calcium. Absolutely.
Okay. That's interesting. And I can understand why, but you see, by taking a heavy dose of coriander, you're getting all the other things that your microbiome actually wants in order to really make a healthy absorption of, I would just add that as well to whatever your doctor says. So, well, the next one there is broccoli. Okay, I think we all know broccoli, and that has a large quantity of magnesium and copper and zinc it's a lot of those. And the important thing, besides what I've said now, is that the essential minerals, okay? Now, you probably heard that term often, and you may or may not know what essential minerals are, and you don't need to know, just eat broccoli microgreens, okay? Your body needs them, okay? So, as we move there, we've got basil. Basil microgreens are a good source of protein. If it's protein you're looking for, maybe you are a vegan, and you need to get your protein, all right, then definitely basil would be you know, must be one of the main ingredients because it's very high in protein. And also vitamin E, which you don't necessarily get everywhere else, okay? And niacin, you might be taking, you know, if you're recovering from something, you might be taking some supplement with niacin in it. And but here it's in the basil, okay? And it's also, you know, they've all got fiber. It's also quite high in fiber and vitamin A and C and K and B6 and folate. It's a really cute little baby, this one. So you're going to get more variety of nutrients in basil than the other two that I've mentioned, but you're getting some in the other things that you are not necessarily getting in basil. So a combination of the three would like sum up everything. Chai, come on, we've all come across chai in our lives, okay? We've had people talk to us about chai. We get adverts about chai. They call it the super seed. Basically, in the microgreen, it's for the protein and the fiber. Okay, and they are full of other essential little things. And when you Google chai or something, you know people sort of say it's the healthiest seed on the planet. Okay, now I don't deny that. I don't support it. What I'm saying is, it's not a bad seed for health, right? So you could include that. But the one that I would encourage you to, and I'm not going to go through all of them, all right? But the one on the bottom left, the radishes. They grow quickly. They grow easily. And wow. And they now have a bit of everything, A, B, C, E, K. They also deliver calcium and iron and magnesium, phosphorus, potassium. And zinc. So, you know, it goes on. But the reason I want to stop now, this one offers the essential amino acids. Okay, those proteins are very important. That you get those essential amino acids in your system. And if you take in enough, if you, you know, put enough radishes in, it's the one of the microgreens. It's not the only one, but it's one. And they're not many that have the essential amino acids. And all of them, okay? All of them, not just one or two of the amino acids you might take on a supplement or something. And then, of course, it has chlorophyll. And I think that becomes obvious because as soon as something gets a green leaf and it's getting to the light or into the sun, the chlorophyll, you know, reacts with the light and the sun and produces other nutrients. And so makes that microgreen even more nutritious than before it became a microgreen, in other words, a sprout. And also the chlorophyll is actually a natural or deodorant, okay? So you can put some in glass if you've got a smelly breath or something. You can make a drink out of it and throw in other microgreens as well, and that will certainly sort out any odors that might be around. So before I move on to the next one, these seeds, they're not absolutely essential. These, but I was just giving you examples, an example that I use too, and parsley, for example, I tend to let it grow so quickly and easy. I let it grow into the plants, okay? And I've got a parsley in a pot, and I just cut what I need to eat with the salads and so on. So, well, any questions?
No.
Okay.
How do you know? You just go with scissors or like kitchen scissors and cut off some, or how does it work?
Okay, I'm coming now. I'll tell you about it. I'm going to do the harvesting and the planting. Okay. we've gone and looked at the seeds, and you've already got a reason to choose the seeds based on their nutrient value and what they do. But there are three other reasons that you might want to take into consideration, particularly when you decide what or how to eat it or what food to put it with. And at the end of this lesson, I will go through how to eat it as well. So just stay with me. So I enjoy a crunch. Okay. So there are a lot of microgreens that have a crunch. Okay. Pea shoots are good for this. They're juicy, crunchy. And you know what? Those microgreens taste like fresh peas out of the pod, baby peas out of the pod. That's what they taste like. Okay, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And so you can put pea shoots on anything. It's only going to enhance it with that slight sweetness that it has. But also sunflowers have a crunch and other bean shoots have a crunch as well. So you might also be like the chefs in the restaurants. You know, they become quite as if they were in a theater and are dressing up their plate of food and you know, a little bit of red and green and mixture and put in a certain position and you get a splash of color. And you know, and there are lots of different colored microgreens, you know, like a purple basil, for example, you know, the red cabbage and so on. So there's lots of options that you can use the color in order just to, for your dinner party or whatever. Okay. You know, even fennel and dill are very attractive in their own right. Okay. And they're beautiful on their own. Okay. So, yeah. The other reason would be a strong taste. Now, some of the microgreens have a strong taste, and you can imagine some of them are like the full-grown plant, the coriander, for example. You know, so they will have a taste, and it certainly might be unpleasant to some, and it's pleasant to others. So you've got to experiment and find the taste that you like, because there are some that are particularly punchy and strong, and if you're looking for a microgreen, then you look at the herbs. If you're looking for a strong taste, look at the herbs grown into microgreens. And as I said, you know, the cilantro and basil and chives and fennel is another one. Sorrel, dill, all have strong tastes. Okay, and you must taste them to decide, you know, which is for you and which is not for you. So, all right, so those are sort of options. The radishes also do have quite a strong taste, but it's a radish taste, you know, and I think we know what that is. And so it's not a sort of strong like you know, some of the others would be, for example. So what I want to show you now, we're going to go through a couple of slides of how to grow microgreens, but I'm going to start with what Catherine was asking for. How do you harvest them? And so now probably one factor you may not know. Sorry, let me just take a sip of water. So is that you can get more than one harvest from most microgreens, not all of them, but most of them. You can get three or four harvests from the same seed, okay? And then you've got to love them. You've got to look after them, okay? And you've got to appreciate their taste and say thank you to them, okay, as you eat them. And if you think I'm joking, I'm not, okay? They're picking up what your energy. So if you want more than one harvest, then you cut them with very sharp scissors or a knife. Very sharp, okay? You don't want to squash them, okay? You want to cut them. And so you cut above the bottom two leaves. Usually a sprout brings out two leaves before any others, and then the stalk grows, and then other leaves come out on top of that. So if they do have two leaves, you know, quite low down, that you cut above that, okay? But if they don't have any leaves right now, then cut at least half an inch or more above the ground level, okay? So you just cut above the lowest leaves, that's always, okay? And if you want to throw it away after cutting it, throw the soil away, you can reuse the soil. And you need it to dry out, just put it, it doesn't have to go into a compost bin, but it can. It just takes so much longer before you can reuse it. I don't use it in a compost. I throw it out into a bin, a very broad bin, and I put it in the sunlight as well, because I want to dry out all the roots now that have been binding the soil together. And those roots are now going to become part of the nutrient of the future. And then before you use it, you can add a little bit of nutrient to a natural organic nutrient to the soil. And there's plenty of that around. Or just mix it with a little bit of new organic soil, okay?
And do you cover it or anything outside? Or is it a bin that... Is it like a compost bin kind of thing?
Yeah. I just leave it outside. I've got a little gap on the side of my garage where the wall's extended and it doesn't have any roof on it. So I just leave it out there. And that gets like 2 or 3 hours sun in a day. And I put my potted vegetables out there as well. And
like a lean-to kind of thing?
Yeah.
And then before you reuse it, you must mix the soil or something, I mean, with your hands to loosen it, because you've got roots that have dried up and maybe not totally composted.
What I do, I took them out of the tray after harvesting them, I actually break them up there and then into the bin, so that the roots then now sort of covered, they loose. And they still need to get dry, but I cover them up. And mm-hmm. I always use my bare hands, okay? Mm-hmm. Because it is, you know, it's know
therapeutic.
It's very therapeutic. It's very, and it's also, you've got microbiomes all over your body, okay? So this is now also helping strengthen your microbiome with the minuscule little things that get absorbed, okay? And you do that, but then go and wash your hands afterwards. You must, okay.
How many days on an average? I realize, as we talked about it, seeds are maturing at different states, but would you say every 3 or 4 days you could cut them?
I'm going to come to that with the next slide. Okay. Let's get there. Okay. So you can grow them in any type of container. Okay, just throw away containers, things that you would throw away and use in the bin. You know, it can be where you bought your meat in, or something you bought your vegetables in the greengrocer in, or something maybe that you put in, you've taken out of the freezer might have a plastic type of, it can be a styrofoam box.
How deep should it be?
About an inch, okay, but I will
just an inch. Now. Okay.
I come to that. I can't come through that. I'm really coming to that. Okay. You use, I've told you this, I'm going to tell you a few times more. Use organically certified or untreated seed. It depends what your local person, puts on it. But untreated seed is fine. And all right. So now we're ready to put some soil in a container. Okay. And remember, you can buy a kit online, and those kits, because they don't ship soil around, they will give you a mat or something, probably made of coconut, mashed up and made into a mat. So that could be a possibility. You'll have anything online other than soil. So if you choose soil, then you must go to your own nursery like I do and get some organic seed soil. Seed just means it's been sifted through and you don't have any big pieces in it, okay? And you could sieve it yourself for that matter.
And hopefully no strange seeds.
Yeah. Okay, so you fill the container with holes if you have to, if there are no holes in them at the bottom, and you then fill it with dry organic seed oil, okay? Then you pat it down very smoothly and firmly. You can use a piece of wood to pat it down with, maybe the wood that's exactly the size of your container, or you just use your hand. I just use my hand, but you don't get it all that flat with your hand, but it's flat enough. You're trying to get all the valleys and mountains out of the container box, okay? Okay, then you sprinkle your seed basically thickly all over the soil surface, okay? Now, you don't want seeds on top of seeds, but you can have seeds right up against each other. Or if you want to make it thinner for whatever reason, you can then just sprinkle it thinner, and that's then your microgreens will be thinner when they, and you know, it really depends on, I guess, how many people are going to eat off this particular harvest when it matures. But you can decide. Then you wet the top of the soil with, I use just an ordinary spray can of water, just an ordinary domestic can that you spray on. Do not use a watering can because you're likely to overwater. You don't want to wet the entire soil. You want to wet just the top sort of
surface,
10 or 20% of the soil that has the seed in it. So you want to wet the soil that has the seed in it, and you want to keep it, the top of that soil,
moist.
Yeah. Okay. So then it needs to go to darkness. Okay. Hmm. Now, there are two ways that it can go to darkness. The way I do, I sprinkle soil on top of the seed and pat it down. Or you leave the seed on top of the soil and you just put a board or one of other containers the same size. You just fit them in on top, put them in a cupboard, okay? A dark cupboard that you don't open and close all the time. But it needs to be dark until it starts sprouting. And you can peep every, you know, start peeping every third day, you know, and see if it's sprouting. And if for some reason the atmosphere is very dry and you can feel by touching the top that the soil is dry, then you would spray some more and then make it dark again. But it must stay damp. Usually with a piece of board on top, it will stay damp, okay? You're creating like a artificial greenhouse, I guess.
What about a wet towel or wet cloth?
It needs ventilation, okay? So be careful of a wet cloth with...
I'm thinking is, you know, a damp cloth, not something that's dripping water on it, but it would be heavy enough to hold it all down, but maybe not dark enough. I don't know. But you said put it in a closet.
You see, wetness, it'll stay wet, okay? If you're just dampening it, I put trays on top of each other, okay? Then I just pick up the other tray, have a quick look. Oh, it's dry. I quickly spray, put it back down, put it back in the darkness. So how you do it and how you create that darkness is not important.
For about 3 days, right? Approximately.
Until it starts sprouting properly, until you see all the sprouts coming up, okay? Now, some come up before others. Wait until most of them, 80% have come up or 90% have come up, then you can take the darkness away, okay? And because I use soil as my main darkness, because now they're under soil, they're dark, I still put trays on top just to keep them dark. All right.
Do the trays have holes in the bottom, do have holes in the bottom, right?
Yeah. And if they don't, you must make holes in the bottom.
You make, okay.
Yeah.
Good question. Yeah, I was thinking you didn't.
No, you must. And the reason you must, I mean, these, I'll show you, I haven't got a tray here now, but I bought some trays and it's almost like a sieve at the bottom, just a mass of holes. Now, the reason that you must have is if you happen to overwater.
Right,
and you
understandable. It's
got to drain out. It's got to drain out, okay? And so you don't want... and also, don't, you know, once they sprouted and so on and you're watering them, my wife heard me and so she brought a tray. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I can't actually see myself, but that's the tray. I don't know where...
Okay.
Can you see it? I suppose... Okay. Okay. Then definitely your soil will keep dry from the bottom as well. And that's important. Now, if you do on the top of the soil, see like a little white that almost looks like mold, don't be perturbed. It's not mold. Okay. It's a dampness that is there, but it's not mold. Okay. And you can just leave it there and sprinkle water on top of it and so on, or you can wipe it away. It doesn't matter. But don't be perturbed. It frightens a lot of newcomers. Oh, I've got mold on top of them. No, you don't have.
Yeah.
Okay. Where you might get mold is if you overwater, and it'll be at the bottom of your trail in the soil. And so that's why you don't overwater, particularly to start with. Okay. And one of the things I didn't say right at the beginning was some of the bigger seeds, if you go right at the top on the left there, some of the bigger seeds, I soak for 24 hours or at least overnight. Mm-hmm. It just, the baby ones, the alfalfa or the chai, I don't soak those. Okay. But just the bigger ones, it just helps the process. But it's not essential. It did take a little bit longer to sprout if you didn't do it. But it, 1/10 microgreen growers tend to generally, soak them. And you can't do any harm to them by soaking them anyway, even the small ones. If you sprout in alfalfa, now you can't get much smaller than alfalfa seeds. I often, when I was sprouting them, I used to soak them in water for 24 hours and then put them into sprouting jars. Okay, so it doesn't matter. But I tend to soak them beforehand. And then microgreens, you harvest above the ground. You do not eat the seeds, okay? You do not eat the seeds. So remember that. Unlike a sprout where you would eat the seed, when it's been in the soil and the leaves have been out interacting with the sun and so on, you don't want to eat those seeds, okay? So just
keep away. Okay, I have a question. Why not, though? Why not just pluck the little things out and wash the roots off?
Because at some point, some of the seeds, would be poisonous to your system.
Okay? Really?
Because of being mixed in organic soil, being exposed to the sun and the leaves bringing things down to the roots, and it won't kill you, all right? But it's just the nutrients are now no longer in the seed, they're now in the stems and the leaves, okay? And eventually they'll go out into the big plant as well. So it's always just safe. It's safe, just don't pull them. If you do pull them out, then cut them off after you've pulled them out, but don't eat the seed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Could you tell me,
Yes, Patricia?
Now, where do you get the seed? I mean, is it you don't just get normal cabbage seed what do you order them from, a catalog, or where do you get them?
Okay.
Amazon sells them.
Yeah, but don't you, Patricia, you don't need microgreen seeds. They're ordinary vegetable seeds. Okay.
Okay.
But you must make sure that they are untreated or organic seeds.
Organic, yes, okay.
Very important. But you use ordinary seeds, and you can buy them on the internet. And as Laura says, she's already seen them on
Amazon.
Okay, good. Thank you.
All right. So here are the images you see here. The person is sharp scissors, holding a few microgreens and then cutting sharply across, either with a knife or with a pair of scissors. And you can still see some of the green left behind. And that's, they're going to have another crop, probably, okay? And so those are options of harvesting them, okay? Then, I often get asked about, how do I store my microgreens? And my first reply is, rather than storing, harvest them when you need them. Let them store on the plant, okay? Doesn't matter if it grows an extra inch, okay? Let it grow and cut them when you need them, okay? But if you do have to store them, okay, and you've harvested them with sharp scissors or a knife, and you then put them, you dampen two pieces of paper, and you put the microgreen between the two pieces of paper. And then you put it into a plastic bag and seal it. Don't take out the air, and just put it in the fridge.
Okay. Damped cloth or paper?
The paper. Damp paper.
But dampened.
Dampened paper. It's the dampness that's the secret to keep it fresh. It'll be just as fresh as 7 days' time. Okay. So
is disease or insects a problem, and how do we handle that?
I have never had any experience with disease any problem with them. So I can't answer from my own experience. So I can only say probably from my own experience, because I've grown microgreens on two different continents, and I haven't had the problem. So, but also washing microgreens, you only wash them when you're about to eat them. Okay. Do not wash them before you're putting them in the fridge to store them. Okay. So, you know, if you're going to, you're going to have them for lunch today, and you're getting your lunch prepared in the morning, wash them then. You can wash them a few hours before. Okay. Yeah. But generally, once you wash them and try and store them, they become, you know, damp and not pleasant. You've lost that sort of crispness of microgreen. Okay. So, but wash them you must. Okay. So you need to wash them in case there's some organic soil, that's stuck to the leaves or something, which certainly won't hurt your hands, but you don't want to give it to your guests. So it's the moisture when it comes to storing. There needs to be moisture in that story. Okay, I said I would bring at the end different ways of eating them. And once you've grown your own microgreens, I want you to come back to this class and tell me how you are eating them too. And as you know, you can add them. That's the conventional way. You can add them to all sorts of salads and wraps, and you can garnish any dish. But you can also blend them into smoothies. And the ideal formula for smoothies is wheatgrass, okay, and broccoli, okay, microgreens.
I got a booyah on the wheatgrass. Oh, no.
Okay. Yeah, so you'll find that, that's a great way to drink it, because it's also very concentrated. And it's quick. It's a lovely way. But any way of eating it, no matter what you are garnishing, it's going to really be, it's really going to be interesting. So here we have a, what do you call that? Okay.
Beautiful.
Yes. Beautiful, you could call it, yes.
Is that squash?
Over here.
It looks like pancakes with something red.
Savory pancakes, you see. You've got savory pancakes, and you've sprinkled some pea sprouts on it. You can see that's now a microgreen pea leaf. And that adds a little, ever so slight amount of sweetness to that salmon pancake, okay?
I was just going to say, it looks like salmon.
Yeah, it is. It's a savory pancake, and it's really great. And you can really load your microgreens onto that, okay?
If I can cook like this, my husband's going to love you people.
good. Okay. All right. On the right of that, this is a roasted acorn squash.
That's my salad squash.
Yes, you did. It's a quinoa salad. Okay. And it's really, you just load it with microgreens. Okay. Mm. Ideal for the vegetarian, for sure. Okay. And then, of course, you get, here we are, a sweet one. Okay. So now you've got a strawberry chocolate tart. Mm-hmm. With microgreen, with the sweeter versions of microgreens.
You know what it is? The microgreens?
Yeah, it's a pea.
Beet? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, same leaf as before. Okay. So it's a pea. And then we've got our conventional spring salad that anything goes and all goes, and it's super fresh and healthy. And it's a way
Is this on your webpage too, Michael?
No. None of this is on my webpage.
Oh.
But what I'm going to do, if you want me to, I can send these slides as an attachment would you like that?
That would be great.
Yeah.
Okay. I will add that. If you, for some reason, it might be the way that you've logged into this class, because apparently there are two ways you can log in, through booking and through live logging. Now, I'm told that I think if you do live logging, you won't get the email. Okay, but you get the classes.
Okay.
So if you do not get the attachment, please just write to help at GetSetup. Okay, and ask for it. And they will send it to you. They're very efficient that way, very good with that. And so
all of this is wonderful. All of this gets set up.
Have you ever used fruit seeds? Like oranges or lemons?
No, I haven't. I haven't tried that. I haven't gone into that. I'm not sure why, actually. I don't know. I grow a lemon tree in a pot. I can see it.
Yeah, I'd imagine you'd have to soak, like you said, soak the seed too to get it soft enough to sprout rapidly.
Mm-hmm. But you've just, I love a challenge and I love a new idea. So I think I might just do that and then bring it into future classes. So there we are. Look at that rainbow salad. What else can you call it?
Okay. Those are those pansies? Because I understand you can eat pansies, right?
Yes. You can eat pansies. Yeah.
So. Are microgreens ever sauteed with, vegetables or anything? Are they ever sauteed, cooked?
Yes. Oh, you can cook microgreens. Yes. Yeah. You can mix them in your pizza cauliflower base and cook them,
Don't you think that if you cook them, that you would destroy some of the nutrients? Yeah.
You would. Any heat would destroy vitamin C. Okay. Mm-hmm. But not the other nutrients. They wouldn't. They wouldn't kill. Okay. And also, you can try and cook it as little as possible. In other words, pre-cook a little bit, and then. But otherwise, just put them on top of your pizza.
That's what I would think.
Yeah. And your soup. I mean, goodness, he has a roasted broccoli microgreen soup.
Oh, wow.
Can you imagine? It tastes really good. But the nutrients, I mean, it's just, wow. Okay. You can add sunflower seeds and other seeds to it as well. And and here comes
the bottom.
What do we got at the bottom? The roast beef tea sandwiches. Now, you guys don't drink tea.
No.
You've got to be in Britain to drink tea.
I don't like
tea. No. There's a lot of tea drinkers in the States.
I'm not one of them.
You have one Canadian. I drink a lot of tea.
Oh, okay.
Deborah, hello.
Yeah, hi. I joined late.
That's fine. Okay. I do the classes pretty regularly. I do sort of probably two or three a month. So you can find if you want to get to the beginning again. But you will get the attachment, Deborah, as well. So, okay. So, and then on the left here, of course, that is quite wild. It's a bittersweet salad, that. Okay. Mm. Purple salad.
But now, anyway. Michael, are these all things that you've prepared?
No ways, I wish.
I was going to ask for you and your wife to do a recipe book.
I do the cooking. I would hate to take a photograph of what mine looks like. I have got photographs. I take photographs all the time, and I do have photographs. But I'm not going to show them to you now.
Okay, Michael, if it doesn't look like this, don't take photographs for us. We just want this pretty stuff.
Oh, do for me. I want to see them.
Another time, not now. Yeah. There we are. You can do it. Let me change the subject. You could do it with your grandchild. Get your grandchild to grow them. Okay. And they get so proud. Because they grow quickly, you see. And within a week, they've seen things already. Look at that salad now. There you are. There's a wild rice salad with microgreens.
Yeah, so, rice would be interesting. I'm going to try that.
Yeah. So you get all sorts of different nutrients from different directions. And
because you said you've done rice, right?
Yes. Rice? No, I haven't grown rice. I have made a wild rice salad, okay? Then we throw in whatever we've got, microgreens and any other fresh salads we might have, we just chop up and put in, and then we might throw a few dried dates in, as well. But I'm that. My wife doesn't always appreciate it. I put whatever there is in. You can't put that with that, I get told.
Oh, yes, you can.
Oh, yes, you can. Yeah, I say. Anyway, any last minute questions, I'm happy to talk about them, answer any questions. I've got the rest of my life. You might not have. So.
Nope. I think you covered it all. Very good. Yeah, okay. Inspired me.
Great.
That was very... Have to start growing microgreens.
Great. Start growing microgreens. That would please me no end, because I know the health that it's going to bring to you. Okay. So go for it.
Good. I'm going to dial up Amazon.
Bye. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye, everybody. Have a nice tomorrow.